Hello and welcome to the fintechNEXT webinar series. Throughout the call, all participants will be in a listen-only mode and will have the opportunity to ask questions via the Q&A box on the screen. Today, I am pleased to present Tim Spangler. Please begin with your meeting.
Thank you, and thank everyone who's attending our event this month. As many of you know, fintechNEXT is our opportunity to present key, exciting, dynamic clients that we're working with here at Dechert and discuss some of the issues of the day. The areas that we're working in over the last couple of years in and around fintech, in and around, as is the topic today, blockchain and digital assets are incredibly exciting areas where there's a lot of change, a lot of innovation. And it always gives us great pleasure to really showcase clients of ours who are doing groundbreaking work. Today, we're going to be joined by Nick Saponaro. He's co-founder and CIO of the Divi Project. I'll give you a little bit of background about myself first, and then I'll turn it over to Nick to introduce himself and to say a little bit about the Divi Project. As many of you know, I'm a partner in the financial services group here at Dechert. My traditional practice over the last two decades tended to focus on financial innovation as it involved hedge funds, private equity funds, private credit funds, venture capital funds. Of late, many of you will have worked with me in the area of fintech and specifically blockchain and digital assets, which is a subject that has grown increasingly near and dear to my heart as I've been able to work on a wide variety of client projects, both traditional financial institutions who are building out products and services in around blockchain, and probably an equal amount of my work is working with crypto native firms such as Divi Project and helping them navigate the legacy rails of not only financial service, but financial service regulation. So with that, Nick, I want to turn it over to you to give us an introduction to what you've been doing at Divi and what Divi's mission involves.
Thank you, Tim, and thank you for having me on the webinar today. I really appreciate the opportunity. Yeah, Divi is a cryptocurrency and blockchain startup that was begun in 2017. We were born out of the ICO era with one philosophy and concept in mind, which was to essentially make crypto more easy and accessible for everyone everywhere. So in 2018, we developed and deployed our first blockchain, as well as our desktop wallet, which enabled people to begin earning cryptocurrency at the click of a button with our now patent-pending one-click masternode setup process, which is still regarded as one of the easiest ways and most sustainable ways to earn an APY on your cryptocurrency. From there, we expanded upon our network by developing an ecosystem that allows for the consolidation of the value chains. We really believe that a hybrid approach to finance is the best path forward to get us to a point where cryptocurrency can integrate with the traditional world as well as be adoptable by both crypto-friendly people as well as people who may be curious or incognizant about it. We, unlike many ICOs of that era, didn't raise $50 million or $100 million. We actually raised only about $2 million. And we, after fees and legal and all that stuff, we probably ended up with like $1.2 to $1.5 million. And with that, we've been able to develop a business that is self-sustaining, that has created a lot of value for the people who have gotten involved with the project, and that continues to build upon itself even today.
I want to eventually dive into the legal and regulatory challenges that you've been navigating over the last couple of years, because as you know, I've talked about in the past, it's absolutely key, it's absolutely crucial to developing a project like yours. But just before we leave the substance of what Divi does, you must look around the ecosystem on any given day and feel that it's a bit crowded. There are all these great ideas. Everyone's trying to build out their own solution and interconnect the solutions out there, given all the other stuff that's happening in the industry, especially as we move now towards DeFi and staking and other innovations. How do you continually successfully set Divi apart from people who will say, well, so-and-so is doing some of that, or so-and-so has a solution that isn't quite horrible? How do you continue to find a place for Divi in a rapidly evolving market?
I think what interests people the most, and this is just based on our own user feedback, is the fact that in an industry that is so nascent like cryptocurrency, you have a lot of noise, as you just said. There's a lot of projects trying to do a lot of different things. But we know from the traditional tech world and basically every other industry, it's not necessarily about who does things first, but who does them best. Mm-hmm. And that's why our focus on user experience and accessibility has garnered such a large and wide user base. People want to be able to access cryptocurrency, even if they aren't technically inclined. And we give that opportunity to people. And it's not just about Divi necessarily, even, you know, our mobile wallet supports Bitcoin, Litecoin, Ethereum, and, and it will continue to support big projects like that by providing these ease of use features that allow you not only just to send and receive really easily, like with a username and an avatar and things that are more familiarized, but also to earn cryptocurrency right from your phone without sacrificing the decentralized nature of blockchain that makes it so great and so beautiful. And by also providing those fiat services, we bring in a wider range of people from a wider range of demographics.
And we'll be talking about that, how crypto and fiat can coexist. And I think there's a lot of different models, a lot of different theories about how much of our future life will be fiat or fiat facing and how much of it will be crypto. Do you want to make some high level points on that? How do you see, again, we'll go into the legal regulatory in a minute, but just the rails and the user experience, how do you see fiat and crypto either coexisting or competing in the next few years?
Well, I think we're starting to see a lot of clash right now. And I think a lot of that has to do with the fact that there's so much fragmentation across both sides of the aisle, if you will. You know, even in traditional finance, you need several apps just to manage your singular finances. And we see even more of that in crypto, right? So I think consolidating that value chain, similar to like what Tesla did, right? Most car companies, they have, you know, a designer in one country, a manufacturer in another, and the supply chain becomes really convoluted. But Tesla decided that they would consolidate all of it. And we can see that they're starting to see amazing success as a result. It takes a long time. It is capital intensive up front, but on a longer scale, it actually tends to be a more successful concept.
No, absolutely. Absolutely. Well, let's start drifting towards kind of the key topic, which is, you know, as we see crypto and fiat compete and contest ground against one another, you know, how digital assets are treated from a regulatory and an enforcement point of view is going to be crucial. I say this on a lot of calls with a lot of clients that, you know, of course you can build that. They'll give me a great idea involving NFTs or staking or anything, any great, really great idea. And developing it and deploying it isn't the key challenge in a lot of the cases. It's navigating the legal and regulatory landscape and avoiding the pitfalls and the era of move fast and break things or ask for forgiveness, not for permission. To the extent it was ever good policy in Silicon Valley, it's definitely not a good approach in and around blockchain and digital assets. I'm going to ask you about some of the things, Nick, in the headlines over the last several weeks, but beforehand, can you kind of frame and walk us through the approach that Divi took as you were looking at the various licensing, the various requirements, things like how do you deal with navigating kind of legal and regulatory, no need to get in the weeds, but just the overall philosophy and anything that surprised you as you went from 2017 to 2018 and 2019 about how difficult or easy or distracting any of the legal or regulatory priorities that you had were. Give us your perspective on that as CIO of Divi.
You know, it really comes down to one word, and that's pragmatism. You really have to look forward. And because it's such a moving target, you know, in early 2017, the ICO rules were different than the end of 2017. But we had great legal counsel that allowed us to have some insight into which direction it was actually heading. And, you know, much to the chagrin of many of our investors and coin holders at that time, we had to take some actions like KYC AML that really, really had a detriment to our actual market. But it didn't matter in the long term because ultimately we protected everyone's position, right? You don't want to, like you said, take this ask forgiveness approach. We're starting to see it in the headlines, and I know we're going to talk about that. But the companies that take this pragmatic approach to their compliance strategy, I think will be, you know, the Amazons, the Googles of this industry moving forward. We see a lot of popular projects right now, but we all know that popularity in the current doesn't necessarily translate to popularity in the future if you cannot continue to operate in a legal way. And the regulations are coming down, right? It's becoming more and more clear over time, but there also has been a lot of writing on the walls for a long time. So we've always tried to take the approach of, okay, even if it takes a little bit longer, even if our community gets a little bit mad in the meantime, they will thank us ultimately in the end because we took that approach.
Absolutely. And I think too often the founder groups that I speak with think it's either or the senior management in a traditional financial institution. Either there's not enough legal regulatory clarity, so we can't do anything. Or on the other hand, given the lack of legal and regulatory clarity, we can do anything we want. And I oftentimes try to get people out of that binary or Boolean approach. I joke a lot that, you know, there will be absolutely clear rules for this particular question you're asking me, client, about this rule or this approach as it applies in 2021. The problem is we won't know it until 2023, and it will be applied retroactively to what we're building out now. It's quite frustrating, but it's quite true. But I like the word that you said now a couple of times, and it is the theme of so many of the projects, not only Divi but others we work on, which is pragmatism. There's usually enough knowledge of other aspects of blockchain, digital asset regulation, or comparable developments outside of blockchain over the last few decades, where we can craft an approximation, which together with best practice and just generally being that good Boy Scout or good Girl Scout, not trying to actively avoid or flaunt regulation, it's possible in almost all situations we've confronted to construct a really pragmatic approach. That together with transparency, together with being flexible, so when the regulators do start pronouncing their views, you're able to pivot, you're able to move, you're able to include that. Allows, I think, clients to not sit on the sidelines. So you can build, you can develop, you can deploy, but have that culture of compliance, be able to show the court or the regulator or the prosecutor in 2 or 3 years, look, sir, ma'am, this is what we were doing in the summer of 2021. And these were the steps that we were taking. We were not avoiding legal and regulatory obligations. We were navigating them to the best of our ability. And I think, you know, we can start talking about, you know, some of the headlines, but you look at the disparate outcomes that are bubbling up. You look at Ethereum on the one hand, and you look at Ripple Labs on the other. You have different philosophical approaches, and you have different reactions from the regulator. Who will be proven right, who will be proven wrong is, you know, for the courts to decide in the coming months. But, you know, we can see disparate outcomes based on how, quote unquote, seriously people took regulation. And you're absolutely right, Nick. Ultimately, it's about being able to demonstrate that you're protecting the investor's investment, that you're protecting their assets, and you're developing that. I think we've seen a much more assertive group of regulators really around the world. I think we're in, as anyone knows who looks at their phone, we're in a period where Bitcoin has begun to move, generally speaking, up and to the right. We're seeing not quite the frenzied rate of 2017, but we're seeing a lot of new projects, a lot of new crypto, a lot of new interest in blockchain. So really seeing regulators in the U.S. and around the world taking more aggressive stances. So when you look around, Nick, at kind of the regulatory and enforcement developments that are grabbing the headlines, you know, what do you see? What are the stories or narratives that you're following in the press about, you know, when regulators are getting more assertive and really stepping toe-to-toe with crypto firms?
Well, I think probably the most relevant one in recent weeks is probably the Binance bans starting in the UK and then cascading down into several jurisdictions worldwide. And again, you know, this is the type of thing where they were taking a shotgun approach. Their compliance strategy was ask forgiveness. And had they sort of taken a more pragmatic approach, this may not be happening to them. I don't think that necessarily this will kill Binance off or anything, but I think that regulators are taking cryptocurrency, Bitcoin, and especially the firms that facilitate the usage of these coins much more seriously, which is a net positive, I think, overall. You know, it shows that, you know, we've been legitimized. This is something that isn't going away. Now, how do we integrate it with the current structures that exist? You know, there's also BlockFi here in the United States, which is sort of like a hybrid DeFi firm. It's not quite DeFi, but it's not quite TradFi. And, you know, New Jersey starting a trend of lawsuits across the United States, I think Jersey, Texas, and one other state that's slipping my mind, are now suing BlockFi. And BlockFi, you know, provides a lending service that is potentially, you know, out of compliance with some of the state regulations. And of course, that remains to be seen. As you said, the courts will decide. It is something that I think should be taken seriously. You know, if you're running a project in this space, the reckoning is beginning to come due, and which side of it do you want to be on? I'd prefer to have a longevity in the space, you know, a business that can sustain many, many cycles and extend beyond, you know, even my leadership potentially. And that's just not going to happen if you take a philosophical approach to compliance. You have to take a realistic approach. I think, you know, there's a lot of people in our space that feel that, you know, crypto is an affront to the finance world. And in many ways, it kind of is. But that doesn't mean that it can't be hybridized and it can't work with that world. And I think that now we're starting to figure out how that's going to happen. I think it's really important, though, that the regulators take the same approach, right, and work with people in the space that are building things and try to build that regulation around how this technology genuinely works, and not try to pigeonhole it or put a square peg in a round hole, so to speak. It's really interesting to watch and a little bit scary, to be honest, just because you don't know what effect it's going to have on the macro scale. But I think it's a really exciting time to be in crypto.
No, it's incredibly exciting. And I do think regulators waking up to the questions that will need to be answered that are on their desks. I think the sooner that they work through them, the better it will be for the industry as a whole. It's interesting when you mentioned Binance and BlockFi, you know, Binance, you've got UK regulators and other regulators around the world. BlockFi, you have a number of state regulators. It's a real reminder that it's not just the SEC or FinCEN, that there are, in the world we live in, lots and lots and lots of legal and regulatory authorities. And there's nothing about blockchain or digital assets or lines of code that's going to change that. We have all lived for our entire lives subject to multiple jurisdictions of law applying to us at any given time and as we fly around and travel around the world. And so there's nothing about the technology that's going to change that. There is not going to be a uniform regulator of blockchain or a single set of rules or two stone tablets being marched down a mountain. Blockchain and digital assets will be forced to coexist with the legal and regulatory framework we've built up around ourselves for the last, you know, several hundred years. So I think it's naive. And I usually come out with that early when I'm talking to clients to think that, you know, they're somehow going to win a philosophical battle, you know, that code is law and none of this should be regulated and all of this should be beyond the reach of any authority. That's just not the world we live in. So any attempt to operate under that assumption that somehow law won't apply is, I think, doomed from the start and is actually counterproductive to, you know, the founder group's lives and professional ambitions and the investors' money they take. So recognize that no matter how brilliant your app is, no matter how great your consensus mechanism is, you're not going to change the way rules and regulations are applied in the three-dimensional world. The other thing that I think is influencing a lot of regulators is kind of lessons learned from Web 2.0. If you want to go back to the late 90s and early 2000s and the growth of the web, and now, you know, the dominant tech companies like Facebook and Google and Amazon and others, I think most regulators now feel they gave those industry titans too much runway. And I definitely think, you know, when I read the transcripts of the Senate hearings and they're talking about blockchain and digital assets, I think there's a real desire not to be asleep at the wheel for as long as they were the last decade or two, and really allow these companies to gain these insurmountable market positions. So engage, understand that these requirements will have to be fulfilled. And I'll say, you know, see it as a competitive advantage. I guess the other way to see it is see it as a barrier to entry. You know, we've had clients look at potential regulatory analysis that we've provided, and I'll grossly oversimplify, Nick, but, you know, we put out, well, you can get 3 licenses or 9. And we've had clients say, well, we'll get 9 licenses. And the theory is very much, well, someone might say, why are you getting 9 licenses when there's an argument that you can get 3? Well, if I get the 9 licenses, then my competitor who comes online in 4 or 5 months is going to have to turn around to their investors and say, well, why did they get 9 6 months ago? And now you're only arguing that you need 3. So in some ways, we've seen clients use, I wouldn't say over compliance, but fully complying in a visible way of winning the hearts and minds of investors, and also demonstrating to the industry that, well, you can't say there's not a path. You can't say that, you know, you can't get a BIT license, or you can't get a broker dealer FINRA membership or the like. As you, Nick, you know, look out over the next few years, and you've got to navigate Divi's, you know, continued success, you know, regulation's only going to increase either its scope or the pinch around the neck of crypto firms. How do you plan for that? How do you fund and staff for that? How do you look out, and as you see all the technical wins and commercialization wins that Divi is putting on the board, how do you budget and plan for, you know, the increasing level of regulation you're going to have to face?
Yeah, that's a great question, and it's something that we constantly are evaluating. Because in the beginning, it was relatively simple. But as we add more products to our ecosystem, and as we forge more partnerships and work with new companies and other coins and things like that, even as a software provider, you know, we're a non-custodial application. We still look at, hey, we should start thinking about MSB licensure. We should start thinking about maybe a BIT license way down the road, those types of things. So yeah, we are building those things into our budget. And you're right, I think people in the crypto space, it's very niche. There's not actually a ton of crypto investors comparatively to, you know, say the stock market or Forex or whatever. The people outside of that sphere will appreciate the investment, as you have mentioned with your client getting, you know, 9 licenses. Mm. They appreciate it a lot more. They see it as positioning yourself for the future. So, yeah, I mean, it does come down to some unique budgeting and forward-looking potential investment and things of that nature. We've been fortunate to build a business that can sustain itself, but that doesn't mean we will never have to grow. So in 2022, we'll be looking at, you know, doing a fundraising round, and part of that will be focused on compliance, legal licensure, and things of that nature. But again, it's a moving target, and it's just something that you have to almost have a contingency budget for, right? So you might have $50,000 a month set aside or whatever, but you might need $100,000 one month or what have you. So it's really important, I think, that firms, even outside of Divi, are, again, taking that pragmatic approach, putting in place structures that allow them to continuously hit that target. Because I'm the type of guy that reads the FATF letter every quarter whenever they put them out, and I read it from top to bottom. I guess I'm a boring guy that way, but it's the type of thing that gives you the insight that you need, in tandem with obviously working with your law firm like Dechert to supplement the knowledge, because I'm obviously not a lawyer, that allows us to at least strategize and project what we might need in the future.
I'll give you my perspective, and it kind of reflects the fact that, you know, our practice has one foot in the crypto native firms like yours, and another foot in, like many people on this call, in the traditional kind of financial services industry. We tend to find when we're working for really crypto native firms such as yours, really the need for our time and advice and work product really amps up right before a funding round. And in the months that follow, because it, really what we're doing in the weeks and months leading up to a funding round is problematizing what the next phase of development could involve and what might need to be done, road mapping the legal and regulatory issues, as you mentioned, MSB and BIT license, and do you need a FINRA broker-dealer or that. Road mapping, and then once the fundraising comes in, then spending that money and giving, you know, we're telling investors, helping our clients tell investors, well, this is what we need to spend money on for the next 12 months, and then do that. So it's interesting how that fits together. The other thing that we've seen, and this is kind of reflecting our more incumbent financial institution perspective, there's a real difference between B2B crypto firms and B2C crypto firms. If your client base is going to be licensed, authorized, registered financial institutions, you just have to front load more legal compliance because you're going to get that question from the big banks, from the mutual funds, from the hedge fund managers or life insurance companies. They're going to have to translate your products and services into things that they can unfortunately or fortunately check a lot of boxes on. So what we find are more B2B crypto plays tend to have to front end that. If you're more B2C and you're really just working with, you know, Bob and Carol and Diego, human beings in the three-dimensional world, a lot of that can be more reactive. Which markets do we want to open? Countries we want to go into? What services do we want to launch? You're really much more in control with that. So there is a flexibility. And one thing I say is no two companies' journeys are the same. So the path that, you know, crypto company A follows is could potentially be very different than cryptocurrency, you know, startup B, based on how they build out and how they engage with their clientele. I noticed, Nick, we only have a couple of minutes left, so I want to give you the last word, or at least the next to last word before I sum up. I mean, looking forward, both for Divi and yourself and the industry as a whole, do you want to give any kind of closing thoughts? Where do you see you and Divi in the next, you know, 4 or 5 years? Where do you see the industry as a whole, the ecosystem as a whole in 4 or 5 years? What are you excited about, and what are you maybe a little bit scared about?
I really feel that this is still one of the most exciting technologies that has potentially ever been created, between blockchain and, of course, cryptocurrency as a use case on top of it. In the next, you know, 4 to 5 years, I really do see our organization having an established B2C presence. And even now we're starting to look at more B2B stuff, licensure. We do have some patents pending and things like that that people have become interested in, especially because of the demonstrated sustainability. So I want to continue to build on that. I want to continue to build out our ecosystem, of course, but also focusing on the value of platforms, right? So not just our platform, but all of them, right? Like you mentioned Ethereum, there are some great projects coming out that support the cryptocurrency ecosystem at large that need the ease of use and consolidation software and opportunities that we provide. So I'll be, and our team will be looking at providing those things and just making crypto easier and easier while continuing to hybridize and work in tandem with the traditional world. I think there's a lot of things to be excited about in crypto. There's a lot of things to be scared about. One of the biggest concerns I have right now is within the DeFi space. I think DeFi, in many ways, adheres directly to the tenets that crypto is built upon, you know, decentralizing and obviating to some extent all of the financial services that exist. But there are a lot of problems with it. There's a lot of rug pulling going on, hacks and things like that. It needs to mature. And of course it will. It's only, you know, 3 or 4 years old, that niche. But that does worry me because it gets so much regulator attention. And I really just hope that the the people that are building those tools and those pieces of software do start to take regulation and compliance a little bit more seriously, because I talk to a lot of these people and they basically just say, well, we'll figure it out when we get there. That's just not going to work long term. So hopefully that maturity starts to, you know, show its face, but I think it'll get there personally.
Fantastic. And thanks, Nick, for spending the last half hour with us. I really advise all of you to follow what the Divi Project is up to. It's incredibly innovative. It's a great reflection of some of the best of the crypto and blockchain industry and what they're building out. Really, really exciting. Just a closing plug, if you're not familiar with it, please check out our Cryptocurrency and Blockchain Resources Center. You'll see in a few days that this webinar will be posted up there together with all of our previous FinTech Next webinars, together with other webinars, other resources. We are a real believer and supporter of the industry, and we want to thank each and every one of you for taking the time to spend with us on this. So thank you, Nick, and thank you everyone who attended today.
Thank you, Tim.
Thank you. This now concludes our presentation. Thank you all for attending. You may now disconnect.